to five people. Rats were the cause of the bubonic plague, but that's some time ago. I propose to you, any disease a rat could spread, a squirrel could equally carry. Would you agree?
Right.
Yet I assume you don't share the same animosity with squirrels that you do with rats, do you?
No.
Yet they're both rodents, are they not? And except for the tail, they even rather look alike, don't they?
It's an interesting thought, Miss Gordon.
However interesting as the thought may be, it makes not one bit of difference in how you feel. If a rat were to walk in here right now, as I'm talking, would you greet it with a source of your delicious milk?
Probably not.
I didn't think so. You don't like them? You don't really know why you don't like them. All you know is you find them repulsive. Consequently, a German soldier conducts a search of a house suspected of hiding Jews. Where does the hawk look? He looks in the barn, he looks in the attic, he looks in the cellar, he looks everywhere he would hide. But there's so many places it wouldn't have ever occurred to a hawk to hide. However, the reason the film has brought me off my house in Moscow and placed me in French cow country today is because it does occur to me. Because I'm aware of a tremendous sheet human beings are capable of once they abandon dignity. May I smoke my pipe as well?
Please, I'll go make yourself at home.
Now, my job dictates. That I must have my men enter your home and conduct a thorough search before I can officially cross your family's name off my list. And if there are any irregularities to be found, rest assured there will be. That is unless you have something to tell me that makes a conducting of a search unnecessary. I might add also that any information that makes a performance of my duty easier will not be met with punishment. Actually, quite the contrary, it will be met with reward. And that reward will be your family will cease to be harassed in any way by the German military during the rest of our occupation of your country. You're sheltering enemies of the state, are you not? Since I haven't heard any disturbance, I assume they're listening, they don't speak English.
Yes.
I'm going to switch back to French now, and I want you to follow my mask around so it's clear.
Yes.
Monsieur Lavalit. Je vous remercie. Voilà, mesdames. Je vous remercie.
Yeah, really sucked into it. That's going to be the longest clip of the whole thing, and we're going to be using that as kind of a keynote before I'm back to a couple times.
They die.
What?
Did they die?
Oh, yes, all number one, yeah.
Watch the movie.
Yeah. Watch the movie. It's pretty good. It's a pretty good movie. That's my favorite scene in the whole movie, to be honest. But that and Brad Pitt's terrible southern accent. Especially his terrible southern Italian accent.
Yeah.
But anyway, so first things first, I want to ask, did you guys feel tense during that, or am I just blowing smoke out my ass? Just curious. Yeah?
Yeah.
Alright, so we're going to make this a little interactive. Why do you guys think it felt tense? And there are no wrong answers. I just want to put that out there. We're going to start over here. We're going to go all the way across. Everyone's going to say one thing they thought that made it feel a little more tense until we run out of things or no one has any ideas. So, you want to start us off, though?
Like the music, like the orchestral, like atmospheric sounds that have a lot of tension going on.
Mm-hmm.
That actor, I forget who it is.
Hans Landa.
Yeah.
Not Hans, that's his character name. Sorry. Christoph Waltz, I think.
But yeah, Christoph Waltz has just this awesome cadence when he speaks that's so just jarring. It's like he's this scheming, calculated, evil person.
His presence.
Just like the way that he talks always puts you on edge.
I think there's also kind of an element of like one-sidedness to it between like you as the viewer and then like the characters in the actual show, because mm-hmm. you're just wondering like when is this dude going to figure out what's happening.
John, can you unmute yourself?
Oh,
get okay. Here.
Oops, my bad.
You muted us?
I wasn't done by accident when I tried to close.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh,
there you go. When I tried to close Netflix on the next line switch. Pass. Jim?
What does it for me is like, you know he knows. He is so smart. So
yeah.
Smart. And he knows. And you're just watching to figure out when the family guy, I don't know what his name.
Monsieur Lepetit.
Levity when he's gonna figure it out that he already is given away.
Right.
And you kind of feel almost good because it's like it's a good thing he said something because otherwise they would all be dead. And like that feeling of like, well, at least not everyone's dead, and knowing that that's coming, knowing like that there's a decision to be made about that, that's what made it tense for me.
Jordan?
The excessive formality of the thing, like
yeah,
right, permission to speak English.
Yeah.
It was just fine.
Alright.
I thought the hospitality like respect was really like intense, or it's just like we're two very gentlemen talking about the lives of innocent people right now.
And that is a very big part of it. Yeah.
Actually, I just think it looks like that in a lot of when Tarantino movies, it feels like.
Yeah. And I'm gonna go explain why right after we're gonna go around the circle here.
Yes.
But it's all good, I didn't mean to start something, don't go ahead. Pass? Right.
Angles. Like, you definitely see, you know, like, when they're shifting down on camera
mm-hmm.
angles. I thought that was really interesting. Nice. Like, especially when they zoom in on space, you know. It was good.
That's a big part of that one.
Was that the first scene of the movie?
Yes.
Yeah.
So you didn't know that they were hiding until...
Until they revealed. But, you, like, I think, Jim, were you the one who said that we already knew, basically, as an audience?
Like, you just, you know.
Oh,
you
yeah.
know he knows.
Yeah. But you don't know where they are.
Right, until they show it. So
right.
that is the very first scene. The only thing that happens before that is Londa drives up, comes in, and starts speaking to Padit, who is outside chopping wood.
Oh.
And asks him to bring it inside.
Is
so.
He's covered in blood?
No. It's sweat and a dirty shirt.
Plus, he's a cow. He is a cow farmer, so he probably butchered.
They're dairy farmers, though, not meat farmers, I think. But either way, it doesn't even matter.
Somebody's butchering him.
He's vegan. He doesn't understand this. So,
you guys brought up a lot of great points. So the first thing I wanted to bring to mind, like what I've said, is the sound. But most notably, in the first like 90% of that, the lack thereof. There was absolutely no music, just pervasive quietness. And that right there, that's more almost like metagaming, because people expect sound and music, which is something we'll get into later, with their movies, because it really adds to the experience. So the lack thereof is almost unsettling. Along with, as mentioned, Christoph Waltz's presence. Because he brings a lot of presence to the screen, and a lot of that presence, what that really is between the characters though, is a manifestation of body language that we don't even pick up. So you walk in, he walks into this unnamed man's house, a poor dairy farmer, you know, he looks ragged, he looks worn, and then you have this guy in a crisp, clean uniform. So he walks in, he basically is asking all these formalities, like, can I do this, can I do that? But you can see he's doing it anyway. Like, he asks as he's doing it. He sits back, the first thing he does, he leans back, very open, very knowing smirk, like, I know what's going on. The whole time, the dairy farmer is always hunched over, very defensive, arms in front of him. And now, as someone mentioned, Tarantino, like you said, it always feels like that in a lot of his dialogue scenes. The reason that is, like I said, the one thing I like about Tarantino is his dialogue, because he understands the pauses. So a lot of the really small, unimportant things about that, the pipe, the milk, all that, just serve to add tension to the scene. Because a lot of times films, like unlike real life, the dialogue just goes and goes and goes until everyone's done. What Tarantino does, he actually puts realistic pauses in the dialogue. Food, pipes, things like that, give the characters a chance to actually stop. Give us as an audience a chance to digest and just feel like something should be going on when it's not. It's like him sitting there chugging the milk, basically holding his finger, like, you know, you guys gotta wait for me. The pan down to like the people on the floorboards, like holding their mouths. That whole like drawn out scene, that's what it is. It's a pause for the characters, it's a pause for the audience to say, something is not right. A lot of it is just manifestation, small things like that. The Pradeep getting up, getting his pipe, lighting it, turning his back. It's just, it's a lot of the small manifestations of things we don't even consciously pick up on per se that create that feeling of tension. And then, like Ray mentioned, a lot of it was in the camera angles too. Slow pans and close-ups are very important for this kind of thing. Because a close-up brings you into somebody's face. It brings you into what they're thinking almost through these small motions and whatnot. So there's a lot of small things. Also, one thing that I want to mention is the lighting. The way there's all the closed windows, it's a very dark cabin with only a few spots of light. That right there, just the fact that everything's been sealed off before they come in, there's only a few ways in and out, that creates like a natural rat in a maze type effect. So as you can see, body language, especially when it comes to dialogue, can play a very big part of it. Another thing is emotion. As you can see, there's like strain in those voices, that very calm, knowing presence, like we said. A lot of that is stuff that is very capable of being conveyed through text, but it's just not as effective because we more intuitively understand what isn't said, more or less. Some other things, like I just said, lighting and color are very, very big. I'm not gonna show all the clips I listed, I just have a few ideas to talk about. Lighting and color are very big in movies because it all goes back to that visual. It stimulates the imagination. That's what's great about visual storytelling. So obviously text stories also stimulate the imagination because you're forced to imagine it, but visual captures it in a different sense. I don't know about you guys, but I'm a very visual learner, right? Like, in order to physically learn something, I have to see diagrams, I have to be able to pick it up and play with it in my hand, model it in my head, if you will. I think in pictures, big, colorful diagrams. I don't know about anyone else. It's like, especially for me, being able to see things stimulates the imagination even more. You see a sense of scale, then you're like, wow, I didn't even know that was possible. The lighting, something starts flashing different colors, like, I'm trying to think of a good example. I got some good examples up here, but for different things. This is a good example. This is for lighting colors. I'll get to my other example.